Going to get back in where we had got off of during our Easter time, and we made an aside for our Easter time services, and now we're going to get back into the Apostle Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, and we'll be in the book of 2 Corinthians today. We're going to be beginning 2 Corinthians, and each time we come now, we're going to have at the very first of the screen, we'll have these four key truths to learn, and this is what we're going to learn from the book of 2 Corinthians. One, we're going to learn that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. The next thing we'll learn is that true ministry in Christ's name involves both suffering and victory. And then we're going to learn that serving Christ means ministering in his name to every need of the people. And then leaders in ministry need support and trust from those to whom they minister. These four things are going to be four key truths that if you want to jot those down throughout this series of sermons, please feel free to do so. That's going to be up on the board at the beginning of every sermon. And today we're going to begin with looking at the God of comfort. The book of 2 Corinthians contains more personal information about the great Apostle Paul than any of his other books. And he wrote nearly half of the New Testament. But the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul he lets us in on his personal life, the personal aspect of his life, more so than in any other of his Gospels. And the first thing, we're going to look at a little bit of an introduction this morning to the Apostle Paul. But we're going to go ahead and we're going to read the first 11 verses of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by God's will, and Timothy, our brother, to God's church at Corinth with all the saints who are throughout Achaia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us in all our affliction through the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings that we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that as you share in the sufferings, so you will also share in the comfort. We don't want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, of our affliction that took place in Asia. We were completely overwhelmed beyond our strength, so that we even despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death, so that we would not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a terrible death, and he will deliver us. We have put our hope in him that he will deliver us again, while you join in helping us by your prayers. Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gift that came to us through the prayers of many. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you once again, Lord, asking that you would bless the reading of your word, Father. And Lord, I pray that it would go deep within our hearts today. And Father, I pray now that you would help us to glean from your word and to be able to apply it in our lives as we leave this place, so that we might be a comfort to others, that we might be a great witness for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul saw fit to tell the church at Corinth about the trials that he had experienced in Asia, in southern Asia. In fact, he said that they were above strength. They had run completely out of strength. They were despaired even of life. They felt like they had the sentence of death on him. Have you ever got to the point in your life you just felt like, I can't take another step? I can't go any farther. I've had all this stuff. I've enjoyed all this I can enjoy. You know, like Jerry Clower used to say, "Woo! Somebody shoot up here amongst us, because one of us has got to have some relief." And I understand that. I mean, we've all been there before, I think, in our lives, that it just seems like that, man, Lord, I can't take any more of this. You know, what else is going to happen? And when the way Paul was explaining that, it was like he was, have you ever just been broke down on the side of the road in your vehicle, your car, and it's just broken, you can't fix it, and it's just, there you are, and it just seems like you're just at whoever's mercy, and maybe, you know, somebody will come along, maybe help us, maybe won't, but here I am, you know, and it just seems like that this is it. I just can't stand any more of this. And we all go through that. If you haven't been there, you will. So just hang on, get ready. And as we look at the great Apostle Paul, and what always amazes, I think, me about this, and what I draw comfort from, is because when we look at the Apostle Paul's life, this is the same guy. Now, he's in the city, was talking about when he was in Ephesus, he was so discouraged, but this is the same Paul that in Acts chapter 19, beginning in about verse 11, Paul said, or the Bible says that God was performing extraordinary miracles by Paul's hands, so that even face cloths or work aprons that had just touched Paul's skin were brought to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Paul was such a man of God. He was so close to God. He walked so close to God that there was a period of time in Ephesus in his life that they could just take a handkerchief and touch Paul, and they could run that handkerchief over here to somebody that was sick, and it'd heal him. Now, that's some healing power, folks. That's some power right there of God. But then here we see that Paul said, man, we were so burdened. I was so wiped out. I was so discouraged. It was like I had the sentence of death. I just wanted to die. Now, why didn't he just heal himself? Why didn't Paul just heal himself? If you could take a handkerchief or a cloth and just touch him with it, and you could take that and heal somebody, man, if he's got that kind of power, why in the world would Paul be discouraged? Why would Paul be distressed? In fact, he wasn't only discouraged, he was sick. He was physically ill to the point that he thought he was going to die at this particular period of his life. And we ask the question, why? And we look at Romans. He also said in Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good of those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. Paul wrote those words. And let me tell you something, folks. That doesn't just apply to good things in our life that God uses. That applies to our whole life. That applies to everything. The storms, the trials, the tribulations that come into your life, God can use those, and God will use those, and he will use those together for good. And when we start looking at these things and we start asking ourselves, well, why is Paul allowed to suffer? Why are you allowed to suffer? Why do we suffer? Somebody asked me one time, why do bad things happen to good people? And y'all know what my first answer always wants to be to them is Isaiah 64:6. There is no good people, for one thing. For all, our righteousness is his filthy rags. But in order to answer their question, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, for one thing, we live in a fallen, sinful world, and yeah, we're going to get diseases. We're going to get things that's going to happen to us. But this passage of Scripture this morning, I think, answers that question better than anything that we ever look at. Why does it happen? I want you to look at verses 3 through 6. Why was Paul suffering? If Paul had all this, this healing ability, he was walked so close to God, why was Paul suffering? Why didn't he just heal himself? Well, this is why. This is why God allowed Paul to experience what he experienced. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us in all our afflictions. Why? So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction through the comfort we ourselves received from God. Let me tell you something. Someone goes to comfort somebody that has never experienced that pain, they can't comfort them. They can't comfort them. I'm called upon quite often at the death of someone's loved one or a friend or a neighbor or something, and I have to go and I go and I minister to them. And sometimes, if they've lost a parent, if they've lost a grandparent or something, I have too. I've experienced that pain, and I can go to them and I can say, Brother Lex, I can say, I understand. I feel your pain. I know what you're going through. Because why? Because I've experienced it. And when God calls upon me to counsel someone that's going through a trial or difficulty in their life, or when he calls upon you to share with a neighbor something, if you've experienced that, if God has allowed you to go through that yourself, then you can be a comfort, can you not? You see what Paul's saying here? Paul's saying the reason that I experienced these trials, these tribulations, one of the reasons that God allowed these things to come to my life is so that God can use me in ministry. Do you think that God doesn't want to use you Why do you think that you've experienced some of the difficulties, some of the trials, the tribulations, the storms that have come into your life? Why do you think that's so? Well, right here's your answer. If you've ever wondered why, right here's your answer. So that you may be able to comfort others. Folks, we all have a ministry. We all have an opportunity to serve God. God wants to use all of us in a mighty way. Because we've gone through it, we can comfort others, our witness. And then when we have experienced that, we need to be able to share. W.A. Criswell told a story one time about a man that worked in the suburbs of Dallas, but he rode a train to work every day, but he was blind. He was a blind man, but yet he got on the train, and there came upon a time that he went to a doctor, and this doctor restored his sight. He was able to fix his eyes. He could see. Man, he was blind, but now he could see. And then every day when he would get on that commuter train, he would go through each one of those cars on the train, and he would ask people, he said, "Do you have anyone in your family that's blind? Do you know a friend that's blind? Do you have a family member that's blind? Do you know anyone? Do you have a coworker that's blind? If you do, tell them to see Dr. So-and-so. Tell them to see this doctor because he's restored my sight." You see, he would go through and he would tell people the good news, and he would tell them where they could go for help. Man, what should we be doing for Jesus Christ? What has he done for you? He saved your soul. He saved you to spend an eternity in heaven. He rescued you from the pits of hell where the worm never dies, where the fire's never quenched. He rescued you from an eternity of that, and we are supposed to tell other people about that. And that's why he saved us, and that's why he saves us, and that's also why we experience things in our life, that we might know the consolation of Christ, that we might be a comfort to someone. Look at verses 5 and verse 7. Verse 5 says, "For just as the sufferings of Christ overflow to us, so also through Christ our comfort overflows." Just like Christ comforted you in the time of struggle, in a time of trial and turmoil in your life, you need to use that in order to help someone else through that time. Verse 7 says, "And our hope for you is firm because we know that as you share in the sufferings, so you will also share in the comfort." In Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30, Jesus said one of the most beautiful passages of Scripture. He said, "Come unto me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. All of you, take up my yoke and learn from me, because I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Now, if you had never experienced grief, if you had never experienced not being comfortable, how could you experience the comfort of Jesus Christ? How could you know the blessed assurance, "Jesus is mine"? How could you know that unless you've ever experienced the downside of life here on this earth? You see, God uses those things. He uses all those things in order to make life more meaningful to us. It's meaningless, though, if you've never experienced it, if you've never had these trials and tribulations. And we look at trials and tribulations the wrong way, folks. We all look at them in the negative side. Let me tell you when your life will change. Your life will change tremendously when you start looking at trials and tribulations and the storms of life in a positive way. How can I use this to give God the glory? How can I use this trial, this storm that I'm in right now, how can I use this in order to glorify God and to give Him the praise? Lord, what are you trying to teach me in this? When are we going to get to the point in our lives as Christians to understand that God is in control of everything? God loves His children. We talked about this a little bit in Sunday school this morning. I asked the men in class, I said, "How many of you ever got up in the morning and wished something bad would happen to your children?" We don't wish bad things on our kids. We want the best for our kids. They disappoint us a lot of times, sure. We wish they would do things different. Of course we do. Everyone does. But we don't wish bad things on them. We wish good things for them. So why should we think that God's got it out for us? Why do we think that God is up here and he's got a target on us and he wants something bad to happen to us? Folks, he doesn't. God's a loving father. The Bible says that he does discipline his children, though, as an earthly father disciplines his son. So will God. God wants what's best for you. God loves you. And when God allows things to come into your life, it might look like a bad thing to you. It might look like this is the worst thing in the world that could happen to me. But God is working in your life because God knows that you need that at that time. And God wants to use that in your life. And he wants to use it to make you better. He wants to use it to make you stronger. He wants to use it so that you can use that in order to lead someone to the Lord. so that they can have life eternal also. God will always use that for the good. In the gates of pearl, look at Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. Revelation 21, 1 through 4, the Bible says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea existed no longer. I also saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride, adorned for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne, 'Look, God's dwelling is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God.'" He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Now, what would you know if you'd never cried? Would you understand that? Would that mean anything to you at all if you'd never cried? Of course it wouldn't. Because if you've never had a heartache, if you've never cried, you wouldn't understand tears coming out of your eyes. Death will exist no longer. Grief, crying, and pain will exist no longer. How are you going to appreciate that? How will you understand that if you've never experienced it? The Bible says that the 12 gates of heaven are solid pearl, giant pearls. Pearls are beautiful, aren't they? You know how pearls made? It's a little sea creature that had a wound. It took pain to make a pearl. We enter the gates of heaven with pain. If we had never experienced the pain, we wouldn't know what the pleasure of heaven is. If you've never experienced heartache, if you've never experienced trials and tribulations of life, you wouldn't know. This is the Apostle Paul. Even though he walked close to God, as a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul, he said that, you know, we trust God, we don't trust in ourselves. You know, there's a point that Paul had to be humble, just like we're humble sometimes. And over, as we get into 2 Corinthians, we're going to find a point in Paul's life in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians 12, beginning at verse 7, he says, "Especially because of the extraordinary revelation, therefore, so that I would not exalt myself." Paul said, this is why, so that I won't get too proud. He said, so that I won't think that Paul is everything. He said, so that I won't exalt myself, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to torment me, so I would not lift myself up. Concerning this, I asked the Lord three times to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, I will most gladly boast all the more about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may reside in me. You see, Paul, he had such faith in God. He was he walked so close to God that they could take a handkerchief and they could touch Paul's body with it. And they could run it over here and they could touch that sick person and they would be healed. But Paul had this thorn in the flesh that he couldn't heal. But God said, I'm going to leave it there. He said, because I know you, Paul. He said, it would be like him saying, I know you, David. I know how you'd get. You know, if I don't have a storm in your life, if we don't have something every once in a while, so it reminds you that I'm God and you're not. It reminds, so that you can remind you that you can't do anything without me. I'm going to leave that there. I'm going to leave it there so that it'll be a reminder that you don't trust in yourself, but you trust in God. Why? Why all of this? So that thanks may be given to many. So that thanks may be given to many. Think about this just a minute. Think about this just a minute. You've went through a terrible ordeal in your life. It may be the loss of a loved one. It might be the loss of a parent, a grandparent. It could be the loss of a child. That's one of the losses that I can't tell someone that I don't know how you feel. I can't sympathize to the point I understand. I've never lost a child. I can't imagine. But some of you have. But here's where God comes into play. Because of the strife and the turmoil that you went through, but the strength you drew from God and God getting you through that and God getting you over that, you'll be called upon maybe where somebody else that doesn't know God, that doesn't know the Jesus like you do, that hasn't had the faith that you have, and they might be going through the same thing, and you might be called upon to go and to comfort them. And you can because you've been there. And unless you've been there, you don't understand. And Paul said, man, I was to the point of death physically. I was wore out. I was mentally, I'd had all I could stand. And then I understood. And God said, Paul, you want to know why you're going through this? It's because I love you, Paul. I don't hate you. I love you so much, I'm going to use you. I'm going to use you to help somebody else. But you had to experience this for me to be able to use you to lead somebody else to the Lord. Remember what he said? So that to Timothy? You remember he said, so that we might win some. So that I might win some. And remember about that? We thought God did the winning. We don't. But you see, God uses us. God uses you. God uses you to lead someone else. God uses you to win people. Oh, we're going to all go through trials and tribulations and storms. The thing of it is do you understand why? God's word says the reason sometimes we do is so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction. Through the comfort we ourselves receive from God, so that thanks may be given by many. In troubles and trials, people pray for us. We all had a part, and now we rejoice together. This church family is such a wonderful family when it comes to prayer. How many times has this church gathered together? How many times have we prayed? How many times have we touched people? How many times have we prayed and we've seen God work mightily in their lives and their body and restore their health and heal them in a mighty way? And it was because we all did it. It's because we all came together. It's because we all pulled together. We all understood that it's not us, it's God. It's never just us, it's always God, and it's about Jesus. Now, I'll ask you this morning, do you know that Jesus? Do you know that Jesus? Do you know him? Have you ever called upon him? Are you at a point in your life where you don't know where else to turn? And if you are, there's only one place to turn. There's only one answer that's ever gonna suffice. There's only one answer that will ever do you any good, and that is Jesus Christ. Call upon the name of the Lord today. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day. Call upon the name of the Lord, because it's all about Jesus. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's not about Vine Ridge Baptist Church. It's not about the Southern Baptist Convention, okay? But it is all about Jesus. He's the one. You're not going to get saved because of the name over the church door. You're not going to get saved because of the name of the denomination. That's not going to get you to heaven. You're going to get saved because it's all about Jesus, because of Jesus. He is the Alpha, the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He is the God of life. And if you haven't trusted Christ, trust him today. Let's stand together with our heads bowed and our eyes closed this morning. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, now's the time to do it. If you've never asked him to forgive you of that sin in your life, now's the time to do it. Now's the time to do it. Step out right now. Come down here. Run down here. Do whatever you've got to do. Come down here, we'll pray with you. We'll show you how easy it is for Jesus to forgive you of all the sin in your life. All you have to do is just surrender to him. Give it up. Surrender to Jesus right now. Say, Lord, I can't do it, but you can.